until the 1800s, it was a requirement in Europe. Every European university had a major department of Sanskrit. When starting in the year 1800, in Germany, France, England, they were all starting departments of Sanskrit. And to get a doctorate in linguistics, you had to study Panini. You had to study Sanskrit and Panini. That was sort of the gold standard of knowing grammar. And then you could study in other, you can look at the history of linguistics. You can ask people the history of linguistics and the 19th century role of what was the relationship between linguists and Sanskrit. You'll see that there. And it took 100 years of digesting Panini into a kind of meta-linguistics, meta-grammar, where the Sanskrit could be kind of forgotten. But now it's revived again because of computational linguistics. To translate natural languages, you know, if you want to speak in language X and have it translated immediately into Y, automated, which will become a killer app, you know, it'll become one of those apps where every telecom network will have it, every one of these smartphones and tablets, everyone will have, you can enter any language, get any language out, it's getting there. The cutting edge of that field is called computational linguistics, and the cutting edge of that is Panini's grammar as the engine. So you go from language X using Panini's grammar, you reformulate it into, you represent it that way, and then you output it in language Y. And the sad thing is that not only, there are two things, not only is the credit to Panini's language being faded and erased, it's being called computational linguistics, and the Sanskrit is being turned into a different code, that's the alphabet. But worse than that, whatever doesn't fit certain pronunciations, certain ways, certain things you extenuate, certain things you emphasize in the way you pronounce, which are extremely important to the mantric effect in our tradition, are being removed, are being erased, because today people don't understand the value. So whatever they use, they're taking it and calling it something else with a new terminology, and whatever they can't find useful is being erased and forgotten. And I call that digestion, like, you know, prey is eaten, and what is useful is becomes part of the predator's body, and whatever is not useful is rejected and thrown, and the prey disappears. So that's how Sanskrit, first it got digested into linguistics, European linguistics, Western linguistics, and now there's another revival of the study of Sanskrit from the point of, by computer science people, from the point of view of computational linguistics. So in 10 or 20 years, you may not need Sanskrit at all, because whatever was considered useful is now in computational linguistics, and you don't need to know Sanskrit, pundits are out, all this kind of stuff is gone. That's what we are headed for. So the influences of Hindu knowledge and thought on the rest of the world are because they go through this digestion. Therefore, we forget where these things came from, because these are mapped and because they are decontextualized from the Hindu source and recontextualized as Judeo-Christianity, Western Enlightenment, Western science, some new kind of a jargon, new kind of terminology. Because that happens, therefore, future generations don't even know where it came from.